All right, welcome to episode number 5 of Living on the Edge. I got with me Mike Terzo from Terzo Power. Mike, thanks for being on the show.
Thanks, Adam, man. It's good to be with you today, man.
Yeah, man. So Mike, you and I have known each other for 10, 11 years now, I would say. Fluid power and stuff on the West Coast. Give a little introduction to yourself and the background and what you're doing now with Terzo Power and, primarily the hydropoles.
Yeah. So I come from the product development world and then moved into the fluid power distribution, working for a big distributor integrator here on the West Coast. That's where we met. And then really as I was going out to all these OEM customers, started seeing that there was really a couple of missing pieces of technology that were out there as in regards to the electrification or hybridization of a lot of the off-highway vehicles and the industrial world too. And that started, thinking about how to solve some of those missing pieces that I felt were going to be important as the industry progresses into, electrification following the on-highway, passenger role model there, the what has happened with the Tesla. So really started looking at how can we bring cost-effective electrification to fluid power? How do we make the systems more efficient? And also the sort of third key piece was how do we make them simpler to integrate? Because that's our industry obviously has a challenge with, getting more skilled people into the industry. So we're always dealing with that workforce challenge. So how do we make it easier to integrate, make it more plug and play? And that sort of led to the development of the hydropulse, which is just sort of an entire electro-hydraulic power unit all combined together. And we really looked at it as a clean sheet rethinking of the whole thing, the whole sort of ecosystem of a power unit, how does every component work together, and then how do we try to apply that to the different verticals that we have in our industry. And that led to originally, what I thought was going to be, is this straightforward? We just take these components, the motors and the pumps and the electronics and software, we just put it together, right? I think 6-7 years later, we really learned what that actually means as far as how difficult the challenge that is when you do that for our environment. I mean, it has to be rugged. It has to be IP6K, 9K. It has to be, flexible with voltage inputs, pump power outputs. I mean, it's so much more complex under the hood. And we spent the last 6-7 years solving all of those challenges, which was a huge undertaking. So, but in essence, it's really just a electro-hydraulic power unit. It's a motor and a pump, and we produce hydraulic flow and pressure. And it seems simple at the top level, because that's all we do. I tell everybody in fluid power, all we're doing is moving a cylinder in and out and spinning a hydraulic motor around. That's it.
Very, make things go up and down and around.
Yeah, it's really simple. And then you get under the hood and it's really complex. So yeah, so our primary product is our hydropulse electrohydraulic pumps. We make them in like 3 different sizes. And we've been on that development journey for quite a while. And now we're working with OEMs and manufacturing and shipping products. And it's exciting times here.
Yeah. So a couple things there. One is, I think I saw some of the very first PowerPoints at a Tulare Farm Show when Elevate was an idea and the Hydropulse was an idea, and we had a shop set up on one of the aisles and we're bringing customers in for presentations to validate. And that was probably 7 or 8 years ago at this point. And I think, to your point, I've been fortunate enough to watch a lot of the iterations. And while the mechanical parts are important, a lot of what you guys have done with the software integrations and talking about the different technologies that are inside that, can you talk a little bit about that process? Because it's not as easy as taking a pump motor, putting it together, doing stuff. I mean, this is pretty some brain work in that system.
Yeah, and it is interesting because it is a true marriage of electronics, software, and mechanicals. There was a lot of hurdles in the mechanicals, you know, but really the digital side of controlling fluid is what we sort of now consider our core competency. It's all digital control. I mean, we've sort of, you know, made up new terms for the industry. We call it digital pressure compensation and digital, you know, flow control or digital, you know, it's because they're, before it was not true digital control of the fluid. And that's sort of what we've learned on the software side is there's so much that goes into really finely controlling flow and pressure. And to do that with a simple, you know, simple interface was a challenge. So we do, you know, quite a few different closing the loops inside. We have pressure transducers inside. We have, you know, we have a lot of stuff in there that allows us to do a lot of math inside. So the end user just gets to say, doot, 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 I just want, you know, 2,250 PSI. And they can just dial that in on the fly and get the flow rate they want. But at the end of the day, it is purely a software algorithm that is controlling the fluid output. And there was a lot of learning, a lot of behind the scenes growth that we found out how to marry those two. That, you know, you can't just take like an inverter from a traction application and apply it into fluid power. It's never that easy, right? Because it's a different work output. And you have to learn all that stuff. So I think that digital control of the fluid is really put us on the forefront of, you know, understanding in the world, really. And it's just fun because now that we've digitally electrified the fluid power, it opens up the whole next level of exciting stuff, which is, you know, the IoT side of it, because now this is a component, an enabling component of IoT and electrification on your machines. You don't have to worry about the hydraulic side. People now can worry about the control architecture, the IoT platform that they're doing. What do they want out of their vehicle versus worried about all this crazy inefficiencies and control complexities and how dynamic a traditional hydraulic system is. All that's gone.
So that becomes the digital operating system for the fluid power system.
Yeah.
In essence, right? If I was going to think about it from a control standpoint, and I'm just going to ask you this question. I don't know if this is true or not. So I'm going to assume it is. So you put a hydropulse, I'm an OEM or a systems integrator. I'm building this new machine and the hydropulse is going to be spec'd in. I have the control platform that I'm used to using, right? I'm using CODASYS stuff. I'm using Danfoss stuff, Parker stuff, whatever. I can start to interface with your control system and you're going to give me the parameters to be able to get the performance I want out of that. So if I'm on an electrification journey, you've just taken literally a calendar year and shrunk that down to saying you want this thing here to do this, talk to it this way.
Yeah, and I think it's more than a calendar year. We've boiled down the black art that used to take people decades to understand on the fluid.
Sorry, I'm from software, so calendar year sounds a very long time.
No, we've boiled down the complexity of fluid power to just that. It is that straightforward. So we can enable them to do what they're good at. OEMs are good at understanding their customers and what their vehicle or their platform has to do for their customers. They don't want to know what really goes on behind the hood between a pressure compensating or a load sense system and what's the efficiencies and what's the, you know, the all these complexities, because we don't do that anymore. We just literally directly control the fluid flow and pressure. So yeah, that it's its own sort of ecosystem, and now it's more of a component. So we can interface with their existing controls platform and allow them to grow through their electrification as they get. Yeah, so we can plug it into, you know, more of a straightforward master and slave system, all the way to each unit can be its own sort of standalone smart pump that really thinks on its own. So we can allow them to do whatever they need to do. We can put it in as a, you know, just to replace their prime mover, and they still use their hydraulic valve distribution system and valve controls, because a lot of these hydraulic systems were developed and tuned over a long period of time. But if you're starting, you know, what we've seen on the electrification is they're starting from scratch on their platform anyways.
For sure.
Don't just take what we've seen in fluid power historically and just take that and add it to an amazingly electrified platform. You know, because then you're just using that to just power a crazy complex and inefficient fluid power system. You know, that's why we're in at the ground floor on the electrification OEMs to design this in, to remove the complexity of the fluid power. You get rid of, you don't ever have to know what pressure drop is, what it means to your system, what a proportional valve is, what a load sense, what an orifice is. You don't have to, none of that exists anymore. All you have to do is tell us what are your actuation functions and how fast and with how much force do you want them to move. And you just tell that digitally, and it's really straightforward CAN communications. It's just simple for electrification.
That's fantastic, because over the years, you and I have been in some electrification projects in our previous life. And to your point, they do take years, right? Yeah. And a tremendous amount of money.
And research.
So I think it's pretty cool to see the idea that was a PowerPoint at the Tulare Farm Show 7 or 8 years ago of electrification and these machines. It really was kind of a bunch of components being system, to really saying, hey, we're going to be like your digital business for this electrification. Like, we have the component we have here, we can accelerate your roadmap. We have a ton of bumps, bruises, scars, and successes to learn from. And so as companies, small, medium, large, are looking to innovate, they're going to look for Terzo Power to partner with them and get them in there and say, hey, we do this really well. We understand the frictions here. We understand the issues that the industry is trying to solve and try to pop in there. That's awesome, because you really are, you're delivering a whole digital solution to a business compared to just an innovative component, which started maybe that way 7 years ago.
Well, that was the frustration, right? That when you're at an integration company in fluid power, you're just given all these components, right, from all these manufacturers, and then just told to go make it work for the customer. And that's very difficult, time consuming, resource, a lot of resources, and then it's expensive.
And then if the technology works, you still have to find the right connectors.
Yeah. So all we've done is done that integration for them. And then they don't have to have that skills, because honestly, it's, again, it's getting harder and harder to get, good skilled people in the door.
Yeah.
And I think this actually accomplishes two things. One, I think we're making fluid power pretty exciting and sexy again.
Yeah.
It's really exciting to new people coming in, because they do like the electrification, the clean side of it. But then no matter what, is we power heavy equipment, that's not going to change, right? We still have to build bridges and move earth. That's going to be fluid power no matter what. So we're sort of blending the old and the new. Taking the Silicon Valley tech under the hood and combining it with, you know, the heavy iron in the Midwest to do this kind of stuff. So it's pretty darn fun.
That's awesome. It's interesting, because we do have a major skill gap in fluid power, right? We have a ton of people retiring. They have an extreme amount of domain expertise. It's not necessarily transferring over. Fluid power companies aren't set up in a great way to transfer that knowledge over. But what we find on the IoT side, you guys are probably finding this as well, is there's a ton of machines that are just inefficiently designed. They haven't changed much over 20, 30 years. And now with electrification hitting that value section where you can make a nice ROI case to put it in. We couldn't do this 10 years ago, right? Yeah. 10 years ago, inverters and batteries and all this stuff was very expensive. So from a young person standpoint, I think we're going to see this massive innovation that's going to happen over the next decade, because so many machines are grossly inefficient.
Yeah.
How they're designed and operated, which is really cool. So can you talk to us a little bit? I mean, my head's spinning right now on like all the different applications. Where are you seeing like the biggest maybe markets and maybe platforms in those markets? They're seeing the biggest success initially.
Yeah, it's changed over the last couple of years. It's pretty fascinating because we work in all these different verticals and industrial, motion control, just mobile off highway and on highway, medium and heavy duty trucking. I always thought, you know, sort of coming from the off highway world, was that was going to be where the adoption was going to take place initially. And but that's not the case. I think what we're seeing, and it's really big, is the on highway medium and heavy duty is just exploding.
Huh.
And that's because, and I tell everybody, it's because that industry is being pushed very rapidly in succession with what's going on in the class 1 and 2 passenger vehicle stuff. And now that's sort of the next domino to fall, I guess, in electrification. So all these OEMs in that space for medium and heavy duty trucking, class 3 up to class 8, they've all been working to electrify their platforms for quite a few years, right?
For sure.
This is not new, but now they're getting to the point where they're getting closer to their SOP, their start of production. And it's sort of like the connector thing that we saw, is that you get really close and then you're like, oh, wait a second, how do we do our steering?
Yeah.
You know, and the engineers start looking at what's out there and they're like, what do you mean there's no high voltage steering solution out there? What do you mean there's no, you know, they take care of the big ticket items first. They get the relationships and vendor and supply chain going, and designs on drivetrain and battery and, you know, the big things. We represent sort of this, and again, that's why we started the company, is it's these niche pieces that I found were missing. I just thought the off-highway would go first, but now it's actually the medium and heavy-duty trucking.
Mm.
Because the off-highway, we have to change their architecture. The on-highway, we can literally just plug this in as a steering unit, and it allows them to go battery as far as what's hydraulically needed. Right,
that's incredible.
Right now, we don't have to, you know, ask that OEM to change their whole platform. And I think in the off-highway industry, the electrification is a different beast because of the power levels that are required.
Yeah.
It's a big difference between a class 8 truck hydraulic power requirements and a 50,000 pound excavator.
And off highway, they're going to do design changes like every 7 or 8 years.
Yeah.
If they do it, they're going to look at the electronic control systems. They're going to look at the IoT systems. They're going to look at everything.
Yep.
And it's going to be either a massive sweep or a massive upgrade on the current suppliers. And I can see that. I mean, that's pretty traditional in the off-highway piece. Super, super interesting. Okay, so you're working with distributors, I believe, nationwide and in Canada, correct?
And we have distribution in New Zealand and Australia.
Awesome. Okay, congratulations. That's pretty exciting. What are you seeing? So a couple of things. Let me tee this up a little bit. Number one is, knowing a lot of the team members inside Terzo Power, I've known for a number of years now with you. You guys are a very innovative bunch, tons of hard work. I mean, anything that goes into a startup, especially a startup of technology and an industrial space, it's a different DNA, right? It takes a different type of person, I think. What are you seeing as translating to being successful inside these distributors and integrators? And what are you seeing as the same thing inside these larger OEMs? What are some of those attributes, right? Because I think a lot of people are trying to find that. How do you either innovate new technology internally, partner, right, with innovative companies externally? What are some of those common threads?
It's, again, I think it's also different it's different in the different verticals, and that's what we've seen is one of the challenges, but also one of the huge opportunities is that the industrial space, because people are making like power units, they're not like an OEM per se, but they're providing power units into all kinds of stuff. You know, it's totally different than the OEMs in the off-highway. And the OEMs in the off-highway, they have to either develop it in-house, which is very difficult as, you know, for bigger companies to innovate. Everybody knows that. Or they do have to partner up, but they're not there yet. I don't think the off-highway, they're not there yet. Everybody's launching, you know, sort of electrified or hybridized. I almost call them, you know, concept vehicles.
For sure.
Different stuff. But those aren't production. Those aren't, there are some, you know,
It's usually fully autonomous, being driven by one of the really large mines or fleets out there, or it's not much change quite yet.
Yeah, and that's why the on-highway is moving so fast, because they have to, because it's accelerating so fast that if you don't have an electric solution or a fuel cell solution, you know, that's operating at the very highest levels of those OEMs. We obviously have not seen that at the highest levels of the off-highway. And, you know, I do have my thoughts on that. And it's because you do the numbers and you really cannot, given today's technology, very difficult to electrify off-highway equipment at any kind of power level, given today's technology. You know, if you're just going to go get an off-the-shelf, you know, inverter and drive system and battery system, and you put all that stuff together, it's not cost effective. And that's what we keep seeing. And that's, you know, why actually on the off-highway, technologies like this are going to accelerate the off-highway as well very, very quickly. And we're already starting to see that. So
interesting.
It's crazy.
That's awesome. So where do you kind of see the industry going next, you know, 5 years, right? You kind of see stuff out in the future, I think, a little bit. You've been spot on with a lot of customers that you and I both used to work with in our old life, and now with the HydroPulse. What do we look like 5 years from now?
I think it's pretty straightforward. So the medium and heavy duty trucking will be completely electrified, ready for in high volume production for battery and fuel cell. Across the board in 5 years, that will be a closed window and done. The industrial side will, I would say, be just getting warmed up, because it involves a different thought process. You have the motion control, and you have all the people coming from the, you know, the PLC world, and you know, you're marrying different stuff with fluid power and motion control and automation. That will be moving, but not like crazy fast. And then the off-highway, I would say there's going to be in the next 1 to 2 years a major OEM that has to take a leap and address what the Teslas of the world have done on the class 1 and 2. And that's going to start the ball rolling in the off-highway. It's just going to take the first company to really make a leap. And that's going to, I would say, within 5 years, we'll be at the beginning of the off-highway electrification revolution. So that's sort of the time frame. On-highway right now, industrial, and then off-highway.
Yeah, it's interesting. And I think the on-highway with industrial is going to help with the price point on some of those technologies to make it even viable for the off-highway to start to pull.
Cost is what we focused on from day one. And that's why you have to integrate everything. That's why we have to,
for sure,
so much upfront thought into it. Our costs, this will be interesting to watch and watch this video in 6 months to a year, because I think that we're going to stun some people with our pricing, and we're going to really open up a lot of eyes, and it's going to be interesting because we can show that we can do a lot of this advanced technology and still make it cost effective.
That's fantastic. That's fantastic. So, hey, if people want to know more about what you're doing, website, where can they find you?
They can just go to our website. I'm really active on LinkedIn, so they can contact me on LinkedIn, obviously, but they can just email me or call us here at our office. It's on our website. We're a small team, so we're super accessible, and it's all about application. So it's all about looking at our customer's application and finding out how do we apply our technology to their platform to make them sell more vehicles or power units or whatever it is. That's all we're trying to do is make them more successful. And if we can make fluid power easier, we're going to make their company a lot more successful as well. So,
yeah, that's awesome, man. I definitely recommend people to reach out to Terzo and the team. I personally worked with Terzo for 10 years, world-class application guy, world-class innovator. So I'm really excited to see how the HydroPulse really rallies in 2021. I know a little bit of behind the scenes and it's looking pretty exciting. So Mike, man, thanks for joining us. Really appreciate it and look forward to catching up.
Yeah, Adam, and especially on everything you're doing out there, it's awesome to see your guys' development, making a lot of improvements, making a lot of strides. It's, again, I have no idea what I can tell people about, but there's awesome stuff going on in Elevate. And again, it's been fun to be on this journey with, people like you in our industry and some other people you've interviewed recently, and it's exciting. We're bringing some more energy to our industry. So we need more people to join us. So,
yeah, thank you. Yeah, it is exciting. I think, a couple of us we benefit about getting together at trade shows or on Zoom meetings and, these virtual cocktail hours, and we can talk and share ideas. But I really hope that the rest of the industry gets to kind of tap into some of this and they know, hey man, there's some incredible stuff happening out here in California, really neat stuff in Kansas or Ohio. And they can tap into some of these folks that we work with that are doing innovative things. So yeah. Oh man, I'm jacked up for the next 10 years of fluid power. I think it's going to be like the golden age of fluid power.
Dude, if young people only knew how much fun this industry was, it would actually be too crowded. So we want people to know, but not too many people.
That's exactly it. Agreed. Well, thanks, man.
All right.
Look forward to catching up.
All right. See you, Adam.